These developments in Caracas, Venezuela are not helping our markets any. Growing instability there as you have two men vying to be the duly seen president of that country. Now we're getting reports that Nicolas Maduro just 24 hours ago was ready to board a plane and get back out of the country, and that he was going to allow the man who everyone seems to think is the legitimately elected, constitutionally recognized president of that country, Juan Guaido, assume power. Then the Russians essentially said, no, do not get on that plane. Stay in the presidential palace. You're not going anywhere. And that disrupted what some thought would be a peaceful transfer of power at a time when a country that is mired in inflation and looking at historic poverty could not get out of its own way. So what's happening right now is a clash as much against protesters and security, as much as security against each other. There are generals in that country who are very closely aligned to Nicolas Maduro, the president, who is keeping them happy, protecting them, providing food and medicine, something the population of Venezuela sees very little of. But the problem is that lower-ranking soldiers don't have the access to the same benefits that their commanders do. And they're the ones who have sworn that they will not fire on their own people. Now, why does this matter to you? Because the Russians are involved. We're told that China indirectly is involved and the Cubans are involved. The White House watching all of this quite closely because there are building fears here that unless we orchestrate, let's say, a blockade of Cuba or tougher sanctions on Cuba to prevent this kind of thing will get only worse. Also keep in mind that the forces that are supporting the generals and by extension Nicolas Maduro are the same forces that I mentioned earlier that are not intending on leaving that country and still stirring up a crisis in that country. You might remember yesterday we talked to Florida Senator Rick Scott, who said maybe American troops have to get involved. Others aren't so sure of that, saying it would be an unwise move without help in the region, including from countries like Brazil and neighboring Colombia. Again, easier said than done. But this has all escalated within the last hour amid signs we are told that Nicolas Maduro isn't going anywhere and has communicated to his generals that he expects loyalty from them. Most have stayed very loyal to him. There are also separate reports coming out of the Venezuelan press, what we get of it, and again, relying on English interpretations of this, that assurances have been made to those generals that even at this late stage, if they switch sides, they will not be punished. But the issue now becomes they're very suspicious of any agreement that would have them going to Guaido. So here we are, stuck in the middle of quite literally a revolution and what to do about it. House Freedom Caucus Chair Mark Meadows joins us right now. Congressman, to call it a mess is an understatement, but what do we do?
Well, it is a mess, and obviously Secretary Pompeo and the president have not only been weighing in privately, but publicly, as you have mentioned. I think the other key point here is that the message to the people of Venezuela needs to be clear. Socialism as a platform results in this, and they have a choice today, whether they take the path of Colombia, which has aligned themselves very closely with the United States on a path to prosperity, or they align themselves with Cuba and Russia. And the message needs to be clear to our Russian adversaries in this particular situation that we will not tolerate them intervening in this hemisphere. And for them to get in at the last minute to potentially focus on bloodshed is just not something the American people will support, certainly not something that this administration will support. And yet, we're hopeful for a peaceful resolve. Those generals that you were mentioning just earlier, Mr. Cavuto, is they need to understand under a new regime and under this new president that they will be safe. And obviously, a dictator like Maduro is used to holding an iron grip on those around him. But I think the voice of those people there, the citizens of Venezuela, will speak loudly.
Well, I hope you're right, but it doesn't look that way. And it might be because the Russians are not allowing that to happen, and maybe indirectly working through the Cubans or even told the Iranians, frankly, I don't know what the the real skinny is, sir. But one of the things that's popped up here is that many in Venezuela were urged not to gather in Caracas and continue with these protests. They obviously ignored that, did that. There were assurances by national security forces. They were told, do not fire on the Venezuelan people. And lower-ranking soldiers said, even if commanded, we would not do so. So isn't this really going to be a test of within the military community who stays with whom? We're told that lower-ranking soldiers are pretty much with the people on this, and by extension with Guaido on this, and that those at the top, the generals who benefited, as has Nicolas Maduro, from things that the population doesn't have, like food and medical supplies, that will not change. And that's where the real schism is between branches in the military. And here we are wondering how to intervene and on whose behalf, right?
Well, listen, I can tell you right now that when you look at just a privileged few, which would be Maduro and the generals that have plenty of food, plenty of condiments to go with that, and yet the vast majority of the Venezuelan people are suffering, not only with inflation, but with just a real desperate time of potential starvation. And so it is key that we have humanitarian relief there, but it's also key that they get a clear message from the United States of America, and that is those freedom-loving individuals will have our support, and we'll have it unconditionally.
When you say our support, does that mean our troop support? I mean, Senator Assad said we need to send troops there. I can understand his passion and his concern, but you talk about a slippery slope.
I think that this will hopefully reach a diplomatic solution. I don't know that there is a real appetite for us to send troops from the United States of America there. That being said, there is a real international coalition that sees what's going on here, with the exception of the few countries that you mentioned. But if you're going to side on the side of Iran and Russia and Cuba and not with other freedom-loving countries, we know that wherever there's the greatest freedom, there's the greatest prosperity. And yet we have Venezuela with some of the greatest natural resources, and their people are starving. It is time that we actually send a clear message, and that is with all the support, hopefully diplomatically and humanitarianly, that we can muster up.
All right. We're going to continue to follow this development, if you'll indulge me, sir, because this havoc just broke, or things really just ripped loose in the last few minutes. So I apologize for that. But I did want to get your thoughts on the Bill Barr hearings. He had a sort of a raucous back and forth that went along, you know, predictable party lines, with Democrats chastising him, Republicans trying to understand what was behind what he was saying. But the gist was that he might have misrepresented a letter that came from Bob Mueller, that he was misrepresenting those bullet points on the report itself. Did you buy that?
Come on, Neil, how can anybody buy that? He was given a chance to actually write and really edit the four-page summary. He declined to do that. And then 3 days later, he wants to criticize it because the narrative is not to his liking. Last time I checked, Bob Mueller shouldn't be concerned about a narrative. Listen, this is all about the Democrats looking for a political consolation prize because the Mueller report didn't give them what they wanted. And yet here we are looking at a particular letter. You know, Neil, it's like going to a movie, seeing the movie, and then later complaining about the movie trailer that got you to go there.
Mueller write it? I see what you're saying, Chairman. I understand that. But it was originally viewed as Mueller upset with the way the press was representing the findings of his report. But the letter seems to speak otherwise. Quoting from it, while we understand that the department is reviewing the full report to determine what is appropriate for public release, a process that our office is working with you to complete, the process need not delay release of enclosed materials. In other words, he wanted more support of the materials. Release at this time would alleviate the misunderstandings that have arisen and would answer congressional and public questions about the nature and outcome of our investigation. What he also seems to be saying is, you're damned if you do, damned if you don't, to your point, you know, get the report out, but if you have to delay it for this other supportive information, I'd rather, you know, that. But that is calling into question whether Barr might have been acting more as the president's lawyer than the nation's lawyer. Is that a fair criticism?
Well, it's not a fair criticism. It's an unexpected criticism by some, but it's expected by me. You know, when you have Andrew Weissman and a number of people that were actually writing the report, they wanted a certain narrative to come out of that. And to suggest that Bob Mueller, after 2 years, is going to criticize Bill Barr for getting information to Congress in less than 2 months, you know, the hypocrisy that you see there is just mind-blowing.
All right, but is it your impression from the letter that he was complaining about the press or complaining about Barr's impression of that report?
Well, I think he was complaining about the press saying that there was no obstruction, no collusion, and I think he had a number of his people that were on the investigation. Now, this is me with a hypothesis. You know, a number of people that was on his investigation saying, you know, Bob, you've got to get the information out there because there are some things in there that the American people, you know, will be upset about. And indeed, we know that Bill Barr did that within 2 weeks. That being said, you know, there is no doubt in my mind that Republicans are going to go to one narrative, Democrats to another. This is literally a Democrat 2020 exercise and a prelude to impeachment that they have long
been espousing.
So
you think
that's
the direction this will go? Because finally, we're going to go to a reporter on the scene on this, and I appreciate your patience. But did you get a sense from hearing your Democratic colleagues, at least in the Senate, that it will be much the same, if not more vitriol, in the House Judiciary Committee, and it's still touch and go as to whether the Attorney General appears before that committee, especially given the fact that Jerry Nadler, the chairman, wants lawyers to be among those asking the questions. And I'm not talking congressmen and women who are lawyers. I'm talking about separate legal counsel talking. Would you recommend that the Attorney General still speak to that House committee?
I would not recommend tomorrow. I would recommend and fully expect that he will be before the House, but it needs to be under the same conditions that everybody else comes here. You know, to suggest that you're going to have counsel come in. The Judiciary Committee is uniquely populated in that we have more attorneys, members of Congress, that are attorneys on that committee than any other committee that is out there. And so to suggest that they're not capable is really, you know, it doesn't
pass the smell test.
If
Nadler insists on that, you would say, Attorney General, don't do it.
I would recommend that he not until Jerry Nadler changes his decision and come voluntarily.
Chairman, thank you very, very much.